So let us continue the
consideration of the problem. So again, we have the same as in the first lecture. And we have constructed an asymptotic expansion of the solution u epsilon of x in the form. It's a u0 of x plus w of x over epsilon plus epsilon u1 of x plus remainder, which I denote by the dots. And we have estimated, at least we have discussed different estimates. Now I would like to process the solution itself. I would like to adapt a form of asymptotics to different purposes of our investigation. So let us recall that W of x over epsilon is but the following term. It's a C omega. It's this is a constant which is proportional to capacity of the domain, then divided by 4 pi modulo x, multiplied with minus u 0 of 0, and then remainder at epsilon here because of this epsilon. So what I want to do, I want to join this term which is of order epsilon with this one. And we will see the following then. Recalling that u1 is a solution of, is a harmonic function in the whole domain omega, and u1 on the boundary is equal to u0 of 0 c omega divided by 4 pi x. We see that the sum u1 of x plus this term without epsilon, because epsilon is taken into account here, is so not plus but minus u0 of 0 c omega divided by 4 pi modulo x. This is nothing but Green function of the Dirichlet problem with the singularity at point zero. So indeed, if we take this factor only, forget about minus u0, we will have that minus delta g is equal to zero, because this is zero and this is harmonics. But on the boundary, what we will have on the boundary in this case due to this definition? We will have, it's a C omega divided by 4 pi modulo x minus C omega divided by 4 pi modulo x. And this is equal to zero. So we just find a function which is harmonic everywhere in omega minus zero. We have to take out this point because function has a singularity. This is a Green function. In principle, this is very simple observation, but it leads to very important conclusions. First of all, let us make conclusions. First conclusion. If we write our approximation, our asymptotic solution, in the following form, expansion of the solution, we, in the following form, minus u0 of 0 g of x plus, and what is here? Here we have to write w wave of x over epsilon, where w wave is just this remainder. W wave behaves like modulo xi in power minus 2. Indeed, a harmonic function with a decay at infinity can be decomposed into Fourier series, for example. And the first term of this Fourier series is nothing but a fundamental solution. The next terms are derivatives of fundamental solution. Derivative of fundamental solution behaves in this way. What we can then conclude is the following. If we integrate over the domain omega epsilon this remainder, we will have integral from epsilon to 1. Again, it's not equality, it's a calculation of order. Then we have epsilon divided by modulo x in power 4, square here, so in power 4, dx, and this is dr, and this is epsilon in power 4 integral from epsilon to 1, r minus, and I forgot here r square, sorry, r minus 4 r square dr, and this integral is of order epsilon minus 1, because it's r minus 2 dr, so it's 1 over r, and here we have small limit, so we have 1 over epsilon. So it's of order epsilon square, epsilon power 3. So if we speak about norm in L2 space, approximation in L2 space, then this term is of order epsilon power 3, and we are left with a very good approximation, with this precision, with two terms here only. So again, if we speak about approximation in natural energy norm, then all these three terms are of importance. If we speak about approximation only in L2, then we can forget about boundary layer. This boundary layer goes to the remainder. But at the same time, we can think about the following question. Where do we need to approximate solution in L2 norm mode? And the answer is immediate. We need this approximation, for example, for energy. I have calculated last time this energy functional, and we find that this is the energy of limit problem plus minus 1/2 integral over omega and then they appear too many minuses, so finally it is plus epsilon u0 of 0 integral of f of x g of x dx plus for capital of epsilon in power of 3. And now what we have here, we have here integral of right hand side with green function is but a value of solution in the point zero. So finally we arrive at this formula. I'm very, very sorry because I forgot here to write C omega, to write here C omega, and to write here C omega. And here is epsilon power 2. So this is the final formula. And in order to have this, to calculate the asymptotics of energy, it's sufficient to have approximation in L2 only. No need to speak about further terms, no need to investigate behavior of solution near to the point, because mainly it is described with the help of this factor here. Okay, so this is the first conclusion. The second observation refers to shape optimization. There is so-called problems of shape optimization and in principle topological derivatives. The problem refers to the following. We need for optimal, we are searching for optimal shape of something. So, and there exist rather classical tools describing how some functionals, some cost functionals, which we need to minimize or maximize, it depends on point of view, behave when you perturb domain a little bit smoothly. But then the appear question, maybe it's convenient to make a hole in the domain. So many reasons. In any case, it is necessary to have a door if you construct a building. And in this case, these classical tools refer to Adamard, they do not work. They appear necessity to use asymptotic analysis. And so it's just this asymptotic formula. So you make a small hole, calculate increment of a functional, and then you can again perturb this hole with the help of Adamard formula. But usually in shape optimization they consider nonlinear functionals, not energy is too simple. So we can think about functional where we have some power p of solution. For example, this is the simplest functional. The question is when it is possible to use this wonderful approximation with two terms, because in a few minutes I will give a statement of the problem with self-adjoint operator which leads to this approximation. When we can use it? So first of all, of course, we have to fulfill the following rule, that this term is defined on this function. Then we have 1 over r, this is the singularity of Green function, in power of p, r square dr, this is Jacobian, integral from 0. Now we want to glue the whole, so we need to integrate from 0 to approximately to 1. And this is r in power 2 minus p plus 1. So if p is less than 3, then this is sufficient. It is sufficient to consider this approximation. If p is greater than 3, then situation is completely different. Why? In this case, we can find the following. Integral over omega epsilon of u0 in power p dx is of order 1 with respect to the small parameter. And integral over omega epsilon of boundary layer term becomes of order, and let us calculate the order. This is the integral from epsilon to 1, again approximate calculations. It's a epsilon divided by r in power p, p, and here stands r squared dr. We calculate and we obtain epsilon in power p, epsilon in power 3 minus p, and here we have epsilon in power 3. Stop, something wrong. Psi can be estimated from above. It's of order 1 plus modulo psi in power minus 1. So what we have here, we have 1 divided by 1 plus r divided by epsilon in power p r squared dr. And so now, again, epsilon in power p, of course, appears, because then you have this. But then we have this guy, r squared dr divided by epsilon plus r in power p, and my calculation was okay. So it's epsilon power 3. So this means that boundary layer is of order epsilon, is of order of volume of this thing. But we cannot use this approximation because the singularity here is very large. And if we integrate the singularity, we cannot glue the domain. The small hole can be glued here because this function is smooth. But this function is not smooth, and we cannot glue it. We cannot the integral over the small region will be of order 1 because of this thing. So that's why, of course, this for nonlinear functional, this approximation form is limited. But nevertheless, for certain extent it works. Oh, I'm sorry, this is not a good example. So let us speak about formulation of the problem which gives you an operator with this solution. This is approximate solution. There is a theory. It's that theory of self-adjoint extensions. What this theory proposes? They propose the following thing. Let us take a domain. Let us fix a point in this domain. And let us speak about a model of a domain with a small defect near to this point. Mm-hmm. Then let us introduce operator A0, unbounded operator in L2 of omega, with a domain d of a0, which is very small. So it's functions u which vanish on the boundary and at this point. near this point. So they have a compact support somewhere here, supports of functions. This operator is symmetric, positive, and therefore, first of all, it is closurable, and closure of A0 is operator A with a domain G of A, which consists of all functions in H1, H2 of omega, such that U of X is equal to zero on the boundary, and U of zero equal to zero. And here we make use of the Sobolev embedding theorem that functions from H2 has values at points. So we have got the first operator with rather narrow domain because of this last condition. Usually if you consider operator without taking out the point, you get an operator in H2 with zero conditions on the boundary. Now we have additional condition. Narrowing domains means that a joint operator will be of rather, will have rather large domain. And indeed, calculations show that D of A star is a domain consisting of functions U, which can be represented in the following form, which are known for us. It's a AJ of X plus B plus U wave of X, where U wave belongs to H2 of omega. U wave of 0 is 0, and U itself, this sum, is equal to 0 on the boundary. So, again, we start with very close, with operator which have very small domain. A joint operator is very large, has very large domain.
Wait, last.
Here not wave.
Ah, okay.
Because constant. Because, of course, you can multiply constant with cutoff function, and then wave will appear. And we see immediately that this domain of a joint operator, this one, is larger than this domain with two constants. This means that index of defect of this operator is 1.1, so one constant and another constant. And this means that they exist self-adjoint operators in between this operator. Okay, let us finalize our small consideration, quick consideration to this formula that A is smaller than A star. I write this this sign in order to emphasize that domain of this operator is larger. Of course, if you take A star, because A is symmetric, if you take A star and restrict on this domain, you obtain A star. So you obtain A, so that A is a restriction of operator A star. And now we are searching for intermediate operator A hat, which is larger than A, which is smaller than A star, so it's in between. But A hat is self-adjoint operator. Okay. So general theory of symmetric operators in self-adjoint operators in Hilbert space declares that under the condition I described, such extension at least one exists. But what I want to describe all possible extensions of this operator, all possible self-adjoint extensions. So to do this, it is necessary to consider the following antisymmetric form. It's UV, and both U and V live in the domain of a joint operator. And here we have minus delta U V omega minus U minus delta V omega. So if we take this form, we find and calculate this form for U and V in D of A. Then Q of UV is zero. Because this function belongs to H2, this function belongs to H2, this and this also. So it's a usual Green formula shows you that this is zero. But it is not the case for functions with singularities. And we need to perform calculations. So we write that U is equal to A U plus B A U J plus B U plus remainder. We write V is equal to A B J plus B V plus remainder. The next step is to use integration by parts, but not in the entire domain, but in the domain with a whole. So this is limit as delta tends to zero of integral over domain omega delta. It's better to write omega minus ball delta of radius delta. So in our consideration, we had here arbitrary domain. Now we cut off a ball. And here we have minus V multiplied with delta XU minus U multiplied with delta X V dx. So we integrate by parts, and we obtain that this limit is equal to minus limit as delta tends to zero integral over dv delta, because all integrals over the exterior boundary vanish, since V is equal to zero or U is equal to zero on this boundary. But on the interior ball, on the boundary, what we have? We have we have V multiplied by du over dn minus U multiplied with dv over dn dx. So we have ball, this is n, and of course n is equal to minus r derivative. So we finally obtain that here we have limit as delta tends to zero integral over db delta. So here we make use of this av j plus dv plus v wave d over dr. I took this minus and now I differentiate in r. Au j plus vu plus u wave minus vice versa, AUJ plus BU plus U wave D over DR AVJ plus BV plus V wave DS. Sorry, here DSX. So integrate over the surface. So now let us look for this formula. What we are left with? This remainder, V wave and U wave decays. It is zero at the point. And that's why when we calculate limit, then it vanishes. The same is true for all the products of B, of constant B, with BU and U wave. But it is not true for this, because this of order 1, this is of order 1 over R. We differentiate, it's 1 over R squared. The measure of the domain is R squared as well. So, multiplying this with this, and this with this, bring us some non-trivial limit. Okay? Again, the measure of the sphere is of order delta squared. So we can forget in this integrand of about all terms which are less than delta minus 2. Otherwise, we have to take them into account. And two terms which appear are those. So we then continue our calculation. Let me write here. Today the blackboard is smaller and it's no problem.
This afternoon
but
will be better.
No, because, it's not a problem for me, but it's a problem for you. I'm sorry. So I continue here. So, and here is the following. We have limit as delta tends to zero. I skip calculations and I write the result. So what we have here, dv integral over db delta. BV here AU 1 over and minus. So the main term here is 1 over 4 pi r, we differentiate and get this thing. Then minus turns into plus here, and we have similar but different expression here. And now R squared is equal to delta. Measure of this sphere is 4 pi delta squared. So we arrive at the following form. It's BU AV minus BV AU. So if we consider this,
why you multiply the main term AVG and the derivative of AUG, this does
okay.
not contribute.
I said that I skipped some calculation because you will have AV, AU, AU, AV, they are
just
the same. And
products
of, yes, they cancel each other. Yes, again, this function GDRG, here GDRG,
AV are constant.
So now we know the following thing, that if we take any two functions from the domain of a joint operator, then we have this BU AV minus BB AU. But if we take these functions from domain of self-adjoint operator, This is nothing but difference of A U V minus U A V, and this must be zero because the operator is self-adjoint. In any, this means that we have to create a domain of this operator in such a way that this antisymmetric form vanishes. And the answer is rather simple. G of A must consist of functions in G of A star such that now we need to put a one constraint of the constant. This function is attributed with A and B, two constants. A, it's a factor on Green function, on fundamental solution, and B is a factor on a constant near to this. And let us write cos theta A plus B sin theta equal to zero. So we put a certain relation between linear, of course, because we are in linear theory, certain relation, where theta is some angle to be chosen. What we have there? What we have there? Let us assume, for example, that cosinus theta is not zero. Then A, B is equal to B, V minus tangens theta. AU is equal to minus BU tangens theta. So if we put it here, we will get A B U V V tangens theta minus tangens theta. This. So if we put this constraint on the constant, we have got self-adjoint operator. We have proven this. The other question is to prove the opposite.
So there is
insertion.
No unique, there are many extensions.
Yes.
Because the theta is...
Yes, extensions you can parameterize with theta which lives on the unit circle.
Yes.
On the half of unit circle, because we can multiply it with minus.
Yeah, yeah.
On the half of unit circle. But the other opposite assertion is the following, that any self-adjoint operator can be presented in this form. It takes some time to prove, and I skip this. Yes. But we have got a family of self-adjoint operators. What is good with self-adjoint operator? First, it has spectrum. Second, it has energy. And I would like to. I need 5 minutes to finish with self-adjoint operators, and then. So. But also what we have now, let us recall our asymptotic form for solution. U epsilon is equal to U zero of zero plus minus epsilon C omega U zero of zero G of X. And this is a good approximation in L2 of omega epsilon. I would like to emphasize that we are just speaking about operators in L2. And what is here, sorry, here not zero, but x. What is here is just a function of this type. Because we can write that u0 of x is equal to u0 of 0 plus u wave of 0 of x. This is a function which vanishes at the point zero. And here we have, this is D, oh, this is B, yes, and this is R. And you see that, fortunately, or because this is a mathematical theory, this U0 disappears. And we have the following connection, that A is equal to minus epsilon C omega B. This means that our idea about truncation of the asymptotic decomposition, getting rid of boundary layer, only about the main term of boundary layer which we put here, is good because it is related to self-adjoint operator. And this means this self-adjoint operator has energy, and I have shown that energy, asymptotics of energy is kept by this operator. So if we calculate energy for the usual definition of energy, it's a one half A U U minus F U. So if we take this energy, then it is nothing but asymptotic of the energy of initial problem. And what is much more complicated story, it's the inheritance of spectrum. It's possible to prove that if we have an eigenvalue of this operator, then this eigenvalue is the asymptotics, two-term asymptotics of the eigenvalue of original problem. What is important that treating one operator, we have take into account not only the main term, it's not convergence theorem, we take into account two terms. Always we get two terms of asymptotics. This approach is of very wide use since maybe 60s in physics. So they consider scattering theory for dirty media. Suppose that you have a media with small increments there, increments in mass, for example. And then how to describe the scattering in this? It's just this thing. I know at least three books which are written about this subject. What is strange for me, but for physics, it is no proofs at all. So they consider this relation as granted. So if we have some defect in the media, then it is supplied with theta. So this asymptotic analysis helps us to describe the parameters of self-adjoint extensions. Theta is called the parameter of extension. Of course, in case of vectorial problems and in case of many defects, they appear many parameters. The parameter of extension. Also, occasionally I found that in mechanics this approach was used as well, and somehow it is related to the famous Eshelby theorem about ellipsoid. For ellipsoid, Eshelby theorem. This is a theorem is the following. If you have two-dimensional variant, if you have a body and you have a constant stress field in this body, and homogeneous, it's very important, homogeneous body. And if you put here inside an ellipsoid of also ellipse also homogeneous, then the field inside ellipsoid also will be homogeneous. So ellipsoid does not influence the homogeneity of the field. Of course, everything is changed inside ellipsoid.
but stresses are still constant. So this allows to calculate these parameters. So, and there is a very, very interesting but complicated book by Kanaum, which creates a theory of defects with the help. Somehow, if you want to prove something which is written here, you immediately refer to self-adjoint extensions. And with Jan Sokolowski from Nancy, we did a lot in this direction. And next, I will show an example where you cannot treat asymptotic approximation without the self-adjoint extension. This is a two-dimensional problem. So, I draw the same picture, but instead of R3, now we shall consider R2. Nothing is changed here. But we will see that everything is changed concerning asymptotics. Let us try to apply the same procedure as before. We have u epsilon of x is equal to u0 of x plus, and we need to find what is the correction. u0 of x is the solution of the problem in the domain with a Gluet, in the entire domain with Gluet hole. And this solution have a certain value at point zero. And as we know, it is necessary to compensate this value with the help of boundary layer. So let us write the problem for the boundary layer. W we have to solve this problem in the exteriority of the domain, and W of psi is equal to minus U0 outside. What we have found in three-dimensional case, that there exist solution with a decaying infinity. What we met here, and there is no decaying solution. Exterior problem in two-dimensional case has this solution. We can be happy that we find this solution explicitly, but there is no possibility to use it because this solution is not decaying. And this means that we cannot construct the asymptotic expansion with the help of the previous procedure. So how to overcome this difficulty? Here I would like to mention Arlen Ilyin, the Russian academician who created this idea in 75, something like this, a long time. The idea is to change ansatz completely. Instead of this main asymptotic term, let us consider this function, this sum of function u with a Green function with unknown coefficients a. So now we have to write that g
G is a harmonic solution of this homogeneous problem, but with a singularity at the point 0. And this singularity is 1 over 2 pi, measure of the circle. And here stands logarithm 1 over r. Plus g of 0 plus O capital of R. So this is the...
R is the normal X.
Yes, R is the modulo X, as usual. So we change ansatz. This is a crucial thing. Instead of solution, smooth solution, we take this guy. Now, what is changed here is the discrepancy. The data for the Dirichlet data. So again, it is minus u0 of 0 minus a of epsilon. What is here? Here we have to put this term, and this is 1 over 2 pi logarithm epsilon divided by rho, and rho is but modulo psi, which is equal to modulo x over epsilon, so it's r over epsilon. Here we had 1 over r, now we have epsilon over rho, plus g of 0. This is the data. And now, we are trying to find the solution with a decay. So, we want to construct real boundary layer with the intrinsic property of decay. So, we try to find constant A of epsilon in such way that solution of this problem decays at infinity. Let us recall the notion of logarithmic capacity. This is the following. Logarithmic capacity potential. It's a harmonic function in R2 minus omega bar, which vanishes on the boundary and has the following asymptotic form. So, in principle, a harmonic function can be searched as a sum of fundamental solution plus constant plus decaying solution, decaying function. This can be derived by many tools, for example, Fourier method. Here, it's a special notation of the constant. And again, without 2 pi, this is called logarithmic capacity. I put here 2 pi in order to match with the fundamental solution. Such function exists. Let us denote the remainder, which decays at infinity, as E wave of psi. And now, I would like to find constant B of epsilon, depending on epsilon, such that W is this one. Of course, it's a guess. Let us try, and if we succeed, then we succeed. in construction of boundary layer. So what we have to do then? Let us calculate the value of this function on the boundary. What stands here? It's 1 over 2 pi, logarithm 1 over rho, then plus 1 over 2 pi, logarithm c log of omega, and that's all. This is the value of this, and we have to solve this system. A and B are unknowns, but we have to equalize coefficients at constants and in logarithm r. So immediately we have A epsilon is equal to minus B epsilon. So here we have the same as here. And now we equalize at constant. It's not a complicated problem to solve this. What we find then is that A epsilon F epsilon is equal to U0 of 0 divided by. So I'm trying to solve this in here, 1 over 2 pi. I will write, then I will verify. Logarithm epsilon, so I change the sign. Then minus g of 0. And then plus 1 over 2 pi logarithm c log. So it looks that I am right. This is a formula for A of epsilon. Is that so? So, mathematical asymptotical jargon, this is called Illinian, like Jacobian and so on. You see that if we take this A, then we have this form, we have W of Xi, now this W of Xi depends on epsilon, but this dependence is rational, and it's explicit. In elasticity, they appear rational, but downstairs in denominator you have a polynomial of order 3, because it's metric. So we have this form, this is decaying, and we must be very happy with this. This is decaying boundary layer. And we can repeat everything. As for three-dimensional case. But what is important, that logarithm
is very slowly growing function. So in principle, in practice, it is constant. So if defect is rather small, extremely small, you can obtain that A of epsilon is of order 1 over logarithm epsilon. And then you can put this in the remainder, but remainder will be of logarithmical order. In this a bit more complicated representation, you have remainder of order epsilon. So let me write this thing. So here you have remainder U wave, and it's possible to prove that U wave epsilon of x smaller than constant epsilon logarithm epsilon. So precision is approximately of the same type as in three-dimensional case, but ansatz is changed completely. Nevertheless, it's possible to it's possible to apply the theory of self-adjoint extension and to get self-adjoint extensions with this parameter as a, because you see again here appear u zero of zero on the, so this is the parameter something like theta I explain. Then this asymptotic representation can be simplified by omitting boundary layer at all, it decays. And this is a function in L2. So we have a self-adjoint operator with L2, which inherits asymptotics of energy and also eigenvalues. And with eigenvalues, it's a very huge problem. Because if you want to write asymptotics of eigenvalues for this problem, then it happens that eigenvalue itself and eigenfunction depends meromorphically on 1 over logarithm epsilon. So it is not rational dependence. But if you model this problem with the help of the self-adjoint extension, you avoid this difficulty. You can find somehow, it's a good operator, you can find somehow eigenvalues, for example, discretize this operator. Only it is necessary to add some element which is which takes care on the singularity of green function. In principle, it is not a problem at all. For example, Kreg theory always treats singularities. And then you immediately have some good approximation for eigenvalue, which is rather complicated story to construct asymptotic form. Okay. So this is one advantage of the theory of self-adjoint extensions. Now I want to compare these two problems, 3D and 2D. So we have u epsilon. We need somehow to distinguish R3, R2. U epsilon converges to u0 in H1 of omega, because I can extend u0 by 0 on the whole, so I can speak about convergence here. And convergence rate, as we saw last, is this one. So it's acceptable. The same is true here, but convergence rate is 1 over. And from a point of view, this is not acceptable. Because if you have a defect of size this, for example, then of course nobody can take care on defects. It's necessary to model this, it somehow
and 1 over 100 in 3D case is acceptable. But logarithm is not so small, so large. It's something like 4. Now, self-adjoint extensions. Modeling. This is this order. But of course, in L2. And now, this comes. And from self-adjoint extensions, we get asymptotics of energy and asymptotics of spectrum with the same precision. While the direct asymptotic analysis brings problems in two dimensions. I have 10 minutes and I would like to mention, I'm not going to derive any formula. I would like to mention a bit different problem.
So it's just as to take into account that there is no H1 convergence, but there is convergence of energies.
So convergence of
energies. So
yes.
Like this.
A lot of different interpretation. I would like to recall that there are scale of weighted spaces where you can play with weights and you can get whatever you want. Moreover, you can play with the influence of boundary layer. Changing weight, you can play with this. And this is it is not.
I thought there is not, there is, but can be of different rates and...
Yes. Of course, rate, from a point of view, rate is the most important thing.
Yeah.
What I want to not to consider, but to discuss a bit, it's a problem of a bending of a plate. The same situation, but now by harmonic equation, and Dirichlet boundary condition. So we have a plate which is clamped over the edge, and hole is also clamped. One can imagine that the answer will be the same as the for Laplacian. So solution converges in H2, now because this problem must be posed for Kirchhoff energy, it's equivalent to H2, but the answer is different. U0, U epsilon does not converge to U0. Where U0 is a solution of this problem. In omega, on the omega.
Well,
U0...
Speaking about H2 convergence.
Yes, of course. Energy convergence. U epsilon converges to US, and S means Sobolev. Since H2, the energy space, in natural energy space for this problem, is embedded into C space, so traces at a point is defined, then US is a solution of the following problem.
Dn, of course, it's a normal derivative. So, if you have a plate which is clamped on a small region, and then if you send the diameter of this region to zero, then plate will be fixed at a point. And this means that this is the main asymptotic term of solution U epsilon. And it's possible to construct boundary layer but the same procedure and this two-dimensional case must be adopted. It is necessary to add here A1 of epsilon, G1 of X plus A2 of epsilon, G2 of X, and then to find a boundary layer, which, by the way, doesn't depend, doesn't decay at infinity, but because of this epsilon, it's of no matter. And G1 and G2 are two Green functions which solve this problem. But at the point zero, you have, instead of delta function in the right-hand side of equation, you have derivatives of delta function. So it's some type of momentum which you applied in two direction. It's a bending momentum at the point. So, and then for A, you have got for vectorial A, you have to derive a linear system of equations and then to find this A. So in principle, the procedure is the same as in the case of two-dimensional Dirichlet problem, but answer is a bit different. So, and I will continue speaking about plates at 3.